Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
A selected text will begin in verse 17, Ephesians 4, 17, where God says, "This I say therefore, and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling have given themselves over unto lasciviousness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. But ye have not so learned Christ, if so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that ye put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be ye angry and sin not, let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil." You know, we're living in a time right now that is, shall I say, uncertain. It has not lived up to the expectation of 2020. We thought that 2020, you know, we all say, well, perfect vision, we'll see clearly. I can see clearly now. Yeah. All obstacles in our way. Yeah. We've got quite a few of them. And so it hasn't worked out thus far according to plan. And so there is a mixture of emotions that are being exhibited by everyone. Lost and saved, you know, black and white, and northerners and southerners. And I mean, there's a full complement of emotions that are bewildering America right now. And someone might say, and this is the title of the message this morning, "I'm all shook up." I'm all shook up. Because what normally happens when someone gets all shook up is they release their emotions. And you never know what you're going to get. God created man as a mortal being with emotions. So we're not finding fault with God. We're all fearfully and wonderfully made. He did a good deed. I'm glad he gave us emotions. But our emotions drive our behaviors. Sometimes our emotions confuse us and cause us to respond irrationally. And we oftentimes regret our unleashed responses. Temperance, as is spoken of in the Word of God, is self-control, or the ability to moderate our passions. The problem that we have today is the temperance. There used to be what was called the temperance movement. Most of it was not in our lifetime because it had to do with consumption of alcohol. But today, I think there ought to be another temperance movement to go on, because people's emotions are not being temperance is not thwarting the emotions that get us in trouble. I think of over in Acts 24, in verse 24 and 25, it says, after certain days when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, which was a Jewess, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled and answered, go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee. But I want you to notice what he reasoned. He reasoned about righteousness. That's the things that are right. See, we process information. That's what Felix was doing. He was processing what Paul had said. And one portion of what he had to think about was what's right, righteousness. But then temperance. I'll guarantee you what happens when many people hear things, at least initially, their emotions kick into gear. And that's why he had to think on, he had to reason about temperance. Should I strangle that Apostle Paul by the neck? Should I feed him to the lions? Should I give him a big hug? He had to think about that. And then it says, and judgment to come. He had to think about the results of his actions. Why? Because Paul was telling him something that was stirring up his emotions. And when that happens, we're all going to tend to respond in our own way. The more spiritual you are, I would imagine, the more spiritual our response. The less spiritual we are, the more carnal we're going to respond, which will get us in trouble. There are many emotions that affect our actions. The list of emotions are extensive, both in primary and secondary, you know, kind of like fallout or resultant feelings. In just about any list of emotions, you'll find the following listed: anger, fear, disgust, sadness, surprise, and happiness. Those seem to be like the main emotions that man exhibits. Surprisingly, anger usually tops the list. And not because it begins with A. But we're prone to that. That's like one of the biggies in our emotional repertoire is anger. And we tend to react with anger. Our text, as Paul is writing this, he's telling us how we ought to put off the old man and all of his deeds, which weren't very good, and put on the new man and be a new character and all. But in the process, he kind of interjects this thought, be ye angry and sin not. Like most of the emotions that we display, there's good and bad associated with each one. Like there's good fear and bad fear. Good fear, the Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. That's a good fear. Unfortunately, man has no fear of God today. And so the good part of that emotion is missed by many. But then in Proverbs 29 and verse 25, the Bible says, the fear of man bringeth a snare. That's a bad fear. But right today, people tend to be more concerned or more afraid of what man thinks than what God thinks. Our emotions are all mixed up. I'm all shook up. There's good happiness and bad happiness. In Psalm 127, in verse 3 to 5, David writes here, he said, lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. As arrows are in the hands of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. Happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. That's good happiness, right? If you have a great number of children, you're supposed to be happy. In Job 5 and verse 17, the Bible says, "Behold, happy is the man whom God correcteth." But doesn't it seem kind of odd that, you know, there's a warning. It was Isaiah 5 and verse 20. Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil. Yeah. Yeah, we're all shook up and our emotions are all mixed up. And when we're supposed to be emotionally doing one thing in the positive realm, we're not. And we're supposed to be doing something in the negative realm, we're not. We're all mixed up. We're all shook up. Proverbs 24 and verse 17 and 18 tells us, "Rejoice not when thine enemy falleth, and let not thine heart be glad when he stumbleth." You know, we're not supposed to have, our emotions are not supposed to be good. They got what they deserve. Glad that happened to them. But the same is true about anger. There's good anger and there's bad anger. In 1 Samuel 20 and verse 30, then the Bible said, "Then Saul's anger was kindled against Jonathan, and he said unto him, Thou son of a perverse, rebellious woman, do not I know that thou hast chosen the son of Jesse to thine own confusion and unto the confusion of thy mother's nakedness?" I mean, he's saying and doing some things here now in anger against his own son. In Exodus 32, in verse 19 and 20, it says, "It came to pass, as soon as he came nigh the camp," we're talking about Moses here, "and he saw the calf and the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot. And he cast the tables out of his hand and brake them beneath the mount. And he took the calf which he had made and burnt it in the fire and ground it to powder." That's good anger. He saw something that wasn't right and he determined this has got to go. However, in our text, we have a direction to show an emotion, yet not to sin as a result. God says here, "Be ye angry." I mean, we're familiar with many of the things that God says where he says, "Be ye holy." And we go, yeah, that's right. But here God is saying in the emotional state, "Be ye angry." There's some things, doesn't it make sense? There's some things that we're supposed to be angered over. But a warning that goes along with it. But don't sin. But don't sin. In the exercise of any other emotion, we're never told not to sin. Could we sin in the exercise of other emotions? I suppose. Anger, fear, disgust, sadness, surprise, happiness. God never says, "Be happy and sin not." But a lot of people have got happy and sinned, right? God never says, "Be ye fearful and sin not. Be ye sad and sin not. Be ye surprised and sin not." Only "be ye angry and sin not." Why? Well, to me, it seems like the emotion that we're most inclined to sin in as a result of exercising that emotion is anger. Could we sin because of any other emotion? Yeah, I suppose so. But the real danger is allowing our emotion, our anger, to boil over into uncontrolled rage. Ecclesiastes 7 and verse 9 says, "Be not hasty in the spirit to be angry, for anger resteth in the bosom of fools." In other words, when we're prone to respond in anger, we're liable to do some foolish things. Right. Some regrettable things. Proverbs 14:29 says, "He that is slow to wrath is of great understanding, and he that is hasty of spirit exalteth folly." Not too bright. Kind of foolish there. I mean, we've all seen anger boiled over, and you know, somebody, an example, somebody gets a flat tire. They get out of their vehicle, they take one look at it, and they kick the door. Well, that was bright. Now, not only do you have a flat tire, but you've got a dented door. See, it's like he says here, it's foolish, it's folly. Oh, I know initially we probably feel good about it, but as we calm down and realize, what did I go and do that for? Paul said in Ephesians 4 and verse 31, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Why? Because of the result. Because of the result. Anger is possibly the most dangerous of our emotions. It is. Because of what it potentially leads to, the resultant thoughts and words and actions that stem from, that are caused by our anger. Unbridled anger is a work of the flesh and is prohibited and condemned in the Word of God. Galatians 5 and verse 19 to 21. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I told you before, as I told you in time past, that they would do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. It behooves us, even as Christians, to refrain from that emotion that gets us in trouble. Hey, we all have flesh, and since it's a work of the flesh, and we're not void of this flesh, we're lugging around with us, this old flesh can take over at any moment. Colossians 3:8 says, but now ye also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice. Oh, sure, he goes on and says, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. But you know what? Blasphemy and filthy communication out of your mouth seems to me to be like the result of anger, wrath, and malice. It's a dangerous place for us to go. We're living in a time, as I said, of uncertainty, frustration, violence, anarchy, which can all lead to anger and bitterness and resentment and literally ungodliness. Paul said in Romans 7 and verse 18 and 19, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For the will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, he said, I find not. For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil that I would not, that I do. Why? Because we're lugging this thing around and we're emotional time bombs. When was the last time you looked at somebody or talked to somebody and they said something like this to you? I'm about ready to burst out in a smile any second. I'm about to start laughing like a fool. No. But people will even warn you. If they look at me again, I'm going to hit them. Right? They better not. If they say one more word. I mean, we're just waiting to unleash that anger emotion. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 9:27, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means when I've preached to others, I myself, the great apostle Paul, he said, I myself should be a castaway. A lot of people have ruined their testimony in a fit of rage. Cain let his anger get the best of him, right? In Genesis 4 and verse 5 and 6, the Bible said, but unto Cain and to his offering, God, he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell, And the Lord said unto Cain, Why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? And what does he end up doing? He ends up killing his brother. Rather than get right, rather than do the right thing. It's a dangerous emotion. It ought to be that, you know, if we get righteously indignant about something, it ought to cause us to do something right. Not to do something wrong. I mean, if he was that angered, he would have said, Wow, God's mad at me. God wouldn't accept my offering. Maybe I ought to change my offering. No. Our flesh thinks like this. Maybe I'll just kill my brother. Oh, that's a good one. Simeon and Levi, let their anger get the best of them. In Genesis 49 and verse 5 to 7, Simeon and Levi are brethren. You know, two are better than one. Yeah. Instruments of cruelty are in their habitation. O my soul, come not thou into their secret, unto their assembly, mine honor, be not thou united. For in their anger they slew a man, and in their self-will they dig down a wall. Cursed be their anger, for it was fierce, and their wrath, for it was cruel. What did they do? They killed a man. Anger leads to probably the worst of our behaviors, right? Where we actually can take somebody's life and feel justified in the process. Moses let his anger get the best of him. In Numbers 20, in verse 10 and 11, Moses and Aaron gathered the congregation together before the rock, and he said unto them, Hear now, ye rebels, must we fetch you water out of the rock? And Moses lift up his hand, and with his rod he smote the rock twice. And the water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their beasts also. Yeah, it might have satisfied the people. The people love it when anger boils over, and they say, Look at them! Oh yeah! Get them! And God's saying, you wanna smite the rock twice? We won't even get into the spiritual application of that. Balaam let his anger get the best of him. In Numbers 22 and verse 27, and when the ass, you know that donkey there? When the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she fell down unto Balaam, and Balaam's anger was kindled, and he smote the ass with a staff. He beat up a stupid animal. Kind of like the Wicked Witch in the Wizard of Oz. I'll get you and your little dog too. Herod let his anger get the best of him. In Matthew 2 and verse 16, then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coasts thereof, from 2 years old and under. And this guy is so upset because he was mocked of the wise men. Well, there, that justifies it. Go out and kill babies. It's kind of the same argument in a sense. Today, a certain crowd believes, well, it's my body, I'll do whatever I want with it. I can kill babies. Jonah let his anger get the best of him. In Jonah 4 and verse 3 and 4, Therefore now, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Just kill me. Just kill me. Then said the Lord, Doest thou well to be angry? Now, who is it that Jonah is mad at? He's mad at God. Because God had told him to go down there to Nineveh and preach to them, but ultimately he wanted them destroyed. And when they all repented, it was like, oh, figures. now be the laughingstock. None of the other prophets are going to want to have any reindeer games with me. God said, doest thou well to be angry? Uncontrolled anger can be the death of us. It can ruin our testimony. It can ruin our lives. Anger is such a powerful emotion that it often leads to sin. However, Jesus demonstrated how this powerful emotion can be channeled for good without sin. In Mark chapter 3, in verse 1 to 5, he entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. And he watched him, whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he saith unto the man which had the withered hand, stand forth. And he saith unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days, or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they held their peace. And when he had looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he saith unto the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored, whole as the other. Here's the Lord Jesus looking around, and he's seeing people who are so religious, so willing to go by the letter of the law, and were unwilling to help someone out in need, saw the coldness of their heart, and he trumped them. He trumped their behavior. They were willing to just let this one continue on in that condition, but not Jesus. Jesus stepped in and he said, come here, you. Put forth your hand. I'll show you. He was angry over that behavior, and he did something about it. Did he sin? No, he did something good. Remember, the Bible said, be angry and sin not. We've got to be careful, folks. Like I said, in the day that we're living in right now, the behaviors that are going on around the nation can push even us to the point of responding in fits of rage. I find myself time and time again having to turn the channel because my blood begins to boil when I listen to some of these liberal whack jobs, left wing, and they justify what they're doing to the point where they're talking about this fire is blazing in the background, and they're talking about the peaceful demonstration. But how can we avoid the tendency to sin in our anger? I mean, it seems like that's the danger, right? If we allow our anger to control us, we're going to sin. And that's the warning. Be angry, but don't sin. As far as God is concerned, we must be concerned about certain things to the point where we're actually angered by it. We ought to get angry with the things that God gets angry with, but not sin. Proverbs 29 verse 8 says, scornful men bring a city into a snare, but wise men turn away wrath. You know what that says to me? It says, use your head. Be wise. When someone is in that realm, wise men turn away wrath. We don't have to respond that way. The Bible says in Proverbs 15:1, a soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. So, control, as James said, bridle that tongue. Just because you can say something doesn't mean you have to say something. And if you have to say something, you can always let your speech be seasoned with salt. Get the bitterness out of it. 1 Timothy 2 and verse 8 says, I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. Sounds to me like when there is a time for certain things that are just upsetting you, that you don't feel as though are right, that there's an injustice that's going on, then rather than go off in a demonstration of violence, he said, lift up holy hands. Pray. Proverbs 19 and verse 11, the discretion. Now, what is discretion? It's the choices that you have, the options that you have. He said, the discretion of a man deferreth his anger. If you look at the different options that you have, you don't have to punch somebody in the face. Paul wrote in Romans 12, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. God will probably do a much better job of settling the score than we ever thought of. Ecclesiastes 7 and verse 9 says, be not hasty. That's like impulsive. It reminds me of Robert Conrad. I don't even know if he's still alive. But when I was a kid, he used to have a commercial on. And he put a battery on his shoulder. And he said, I dare you, knock it off. That's how many people go through life. They're daring someone to anger them so that they can respond in a fit of... He said, be not hasty in thy spirit to be angry. Some people are just walking around like this. What are you looking at? Did you say something? Really, they're hasty. They can't wait. They even tell other people. They'll tell them, yeah, if you ever said that to me, boy, you'd see a response. I saw something. I don't know if it was made up or not. I forget what state it was in, but they were bragging. I think it was like Idaho or something. But there was an act of road rage that went on. And there were two guys, each out of their own vehicles, and they were out there, and they were pounding on each other. They were on the ground, and they're pounding each other. All of a sudden, they stopped, and then they got up, and they picked up their stuff, and they shook hands and got back in their cars. I thought, was that staged, or... Now, whether or not that was real or not, I don't think it was. Because it just doesn't seem like it's truthful. Because we don't respond that way. Once we unload, we unleash our wrath, our anger, it usually carries on for a long time. James 1:19 says, wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. If you're going to get angry, and God already said, be angry and sin not, and take your time. Think it out. Choose your words carefully. One last thought on that. Proverbs 22 and verse 24 says, make no friendship with an angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go. Why? Because you are right now, or very soon will be, exactly as your friends are. So you may not be an angry person. You may not be a bitter person. You may not be filled with wrath. But if you're going with somebody that is, count on it. It'll rub off on you. Birds of a feather stick together. One final thought this morning on this. When you do get angry, righteously or unrighteously. The verse did not end with be ye angry and sin not. It says, there's a colon there. It says, be ye angry and sin not, let not the sun go down upon your wrath. It happens. And if we're doing something that's right, then I guess we've got nothing to apologize for. But if we have ever found ourselves uncontrolled, and our flesh got the best of us, because that's where it's coming from, and our emotion went over the top, and we said or thought or acted in a certain way, then God said, let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Before the day's over, get it right. Too many people carry on a grudge for the remainder of their lives because of some momentary outburst of emotion in anger. Get it right quickly. With all this coronavirus complicating our lives and limiting our freedoms, it's easy to lash out. With all the political rhetoric beginning to ramp up to vicious attacks upon our president, it's easy for us to spew up, boil over. With the outpouring of violence in the streets of America, very easy for our emotion of anger to rise, to our face to get red. We're living. Remember, he said, this know also, in the last days, perilous times shall come. He goes off to say, well, men should be lovers of themselves, covetous, boasters, proud, blessed. But if we just stopped with the thought, perilous times, we're in perilous times right now. People are doing things today that 6 months ago, they never thought of doing. And it seems to me, because so many people are all shook up, the danger is that our society, yea, even Christianity, is boiling over in anger. The warning here, be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Think about it, folks. Control it. Control it. One quick story. I remember in jail many years ago, I talked to a man who was serving life. And he was serving life because he killed his wife and her lover. He had no record whatsoever. He came home one day and there they were. He went into the closet, took out a shotgun, and sent them both to eternity. And he's serving now. I understand the anger, but is it worth spending the rest of your natural born days in jail over? He told me he wished he had, you know, he could have just as easily turned around and walked out.
Right.
You know. Be careful, folks. Anger is the most dangerous of our emotions. And it can get us in trouble.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. And our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508 883-5302. For additional information about our church, please visit our website at solidrockbbc.com. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and you must be born again. Thank you for watching.